29مین سالگرد قتل عام زندانیان سیاسی توسط جلادان ولایت فقیه. جنبش دادخواهی شهیدان قتل عام 67 بخش ضروری کارزار ملت ایران برای سرنگونی. اینگرید بتانکور: ما امروز خواهان آغاز روند محاکمه در مورد جنایت علیه بشریت هستیم که در تابستان 1988 با فتوای خمینی شروع شد و به اعدام 30,000 انسان انجامید.
There are no words for me to express the feeling, the emotion of being with you today, because we have fought so much during so many years to bring you alive to freedom. It's a blessing to be here with you, to see your faces, to see the joy and the force, the strength in you. And so, as I'm rejoicing of being able to see you and to be with you, then I feel that we have gained the freedom to look back and to ponder and to reflect on what has happened. 30 years ago, 29 to be exact, Khomeini, Ayatollah Khomeini, came with a fatwa that none of us will ever forget. It was a decree that opened the way for the most outrageous cruelty, only comparable to the final solution Hitler enacted years before during the Second World War. It was about extermination. It was about mass killings only on the basis of people that were to be executed because they didn't think like the Ayatollah Khomeini. This was the starting chapter of the most cruel years in the history of the people of Iran. Ayatollah Khomeini knew the world. He knew how we thought in the Western world and how the people in Iran felt about the revolution. So to disguise this terrible crime in legality, he gave the order to establish a panel of three appointees in order to have, like, the appearance of trials, and 30,000 people were killed without any legal support by the state and by the government and through the minister and the Ministry of Justice of the regime of Khomeini. When I think about what happened 29 years ago in Iran, it makes me think that something in this puzzle is missing. You see, the very frightening part of this story is that we have all the information. We have all the names. We have all the documents, the proofs. We have the witnesses. We have the survivors, you. We have the testimonies. We even have the confession of those who perpetrated those crimes. We have it all, but we still have impunity. Today, the criminals that perpetrated those crimes are in highest position in the government in Iran. They are high officials of the regime. Today, the families, as we have seen, are still crying for those they lost. And today, there are people being abused through legal means because they are asking answers and justice. So, why does it matter today? It matters today because we are alive, because we have the knowledge, we have the information, and we have the tools to turn bad into good through justice. If we are silent, if we pretend to ignore, if we pretend we don't know, we become accomplices of the crime. To be free is to bear the responsibility of doing what we have to do when we can't do it. And now that we are here in Tirana, that you are free and alive, and that we are with you, and that the world is with you, we have the duty to unite and demand justice. It is not sufficient for all the people that are alive in the world to just set aside and say, it's not my problem. It's always our problem. Impunity, injustice is always our problem. So, how can we honor those 30,000 brothers, sisters, humans, Iranians, loved ones, those lives that were taken away without being able to produce and give and love and share all they were meant to give and share when they were born? How can we honor the loss of the people we love? The only way is by asking the world to give us what has been taken away from us, which is justice. We need to ask the UN to play its role. There is a High Commissioner for Human Rights in the UN. This is the first step. We need to ask the High Commissioner to begin an independent inquiry to investigate what we know, to be able to give to a third neutral party all the information of what happened, so that in justice this investigation, neutral investigation, can come up with the conclusions that will then open the path for a trial. When Hitler was in power, those were laws, to exterminate the Jews in the concentration camps, those were laws. It was legal to rule and to execute massively human beings because of their religion. That was a law. But it's not because it was a law that it was legal or just. And then the world came up with the Nuremberg trial, where the victims came and spoke and gave the voice and pointed fingers to the criminals that were responsible for those crimes. And it was not enough to say, I was told, I was following orders. It was not enough to say, I wasn't aware. We are demanding today to begin the process for a trial against the crime against humanity that began on the summer of 1988 with the fatwa issued by Khomeini that brought to execution 30,000 human beings. That's what we are asking for. We want a trial. We want the victims to be heard. We want the proofs to be brought. We want justice to be done. It's not enough to confess every day, as they do from Tehran, saying that yes, they killed 30,000 people, but it was to preserve the revolution, or it was needed because of the moment, or because it was the wisdom of Khomeini. All those who are trying to defend the legacy of Khomeini are in fact trying to divert justice from their own responsibility. Khomeini is gone. He's not alive anymore. And history is judging him. But those who are alive today have to go to trial. And we need to take them to trial. And it needs to be in international court. And we will not have any rest until this is achieved, as we didn't stop until you came back from Iraq and from Camp Liberty. So when I was reflecting on how to make it, to visualize the pain, the horror, and to move the souls and the hearts of those we need to hear us, I thought, what about committing ourselves to plant a tree in the name of each of the Iranians that will attain justice after a trial. Just imagine this arboretum of 30,000 trees with a personal name that we can go and visit and understand what our action meant. That is the date I have with you. Because one day, not only we will turn around this impunity and we will be able to have the criminals brought to justice, but one day also we will be able to come to Tehran and to turn those mass graves into beautiful arboretums of trees bearing the names of your brothers and my sisters and your sisters and my brothers. There is no biggest power against dictatorship than hope. You know that. I know that. So in the hope of gathering together in Tehran to plant those trees, I leave you with my dreams.
Signora Presidente Rajavi, cari amici, signore e signori, vorrei davvero ringraziarvi per avermi invitato a questo importante evento sui diritti umani in Iran e per commemorare le vittime del massacro del 1988. Ho di fronte a me i coraggiosi combattenti dell'opposizione iraniana che hanno lottato contro uno dei più brutali regimi del nostro tempo. Mi dovrei inginocchiare di fronte a voi, sono onorato. Voi avete pagato. Voi avete pagato un prezzo altissimo, ciascuno di voi con tutta la sua vita, per mantenere viva la fiamma della libertà, della speranza, della resistenza, affinché il popolo dell'Iran un giorno sia finalmente libero. Lo abbiamo sentito, abbiamo ricordato i vostri giorni difficili ad Ashraf e a Liberty, gli attacchi brutali, i massacri di gente innocente e indifesa, ma voi avete combattuto e resistito laggiù a mani nude, senza armi, contro i proiettili, contro i missili e alla fine ne siete usciti vincitori. Io, noi siamo felici di vedervi tutti sani e salvi qui a Tirana. Il vostro trasferimento in sicurezza qui è stato un colpo durissimo per il regime degli Ayatollah, dei Mullah in Iran. Ora voi siete al sicuro qui e sentite tutta la responsabilità di aiutare il vostro popolo in Iran ad essere presto libero. Il massacro del 1988 resta uno dei più grandi crimini commessi contro l'umanità. È venuto il tempo di portare questo massacro di fronte ai tribunali internazionali. Finalmente Amnesty International ha pubblicato un rapporto proprio recentemente nel quale sottolinea che la repressione contro i dissidenti e coloro i quali difendono i diritti delle persone è drammaticamente aumentato con Rouhani. Bisogna dire basta ad un regime che ammazza donne e bambini come nessun paese al mondo. A seguito delle pressioni internazionali, Rouhani è stato costretto a rimuovere nel suo secondo mandato il ministro Pourhammadi, ma ha nominato un altro protagonista di quella famigerata commissione della morte, Alireza Avaè. Avaè ordinò l'esecuzione di ragazzi al di sotto dei 18 anni di età e tra questi anche molte ragazze. Risulta quindi chiaro che coloro i quali commisero questi crimini 29-30 anni fa sono ancora al potere in Iran. E allora hanno detto bene le persone che mi hanno preceduto, i nostri governi, l'Unione Europea, devono considerare i diritti umani una loro priorità nei rapporti con il regime di Teheran. Non ci sono interessi di realpolitik, interessi commerciali, industriali, economici che vengono prima dei diritti umani in Iran. Dobbiamo chiedere tutte le persone che amano la libertà, la giustizia, l'affermazione dei diritti umani nel mondo, che ci sia un'approfondita analisi, indagine delle Nazioni Unite sui fatti del 1988. Khamenei, Rouhani e tutti quelli che ancora ricoprono incarichi di vertice nel regime e sono coinvolti nel massacro del 1988 devono essere processati dal Tribunale Internazionale dell'Aia. Nessuno sconto. I paesi occidentali sono colpevoli, sono in ritardo, ma finalmente qualcosa si muove. In Italia, nel mese di giugno, la maggioranza dei parlamentari ha firmato un documento di condanna del massacro del 1988 e il Parlamento italiano chiede di processare i mandanti e gli esecutori di quel massacro. Grazie, Madame Rajavi, Presidente della Resistenza iraniana, per aver promosso questa campagna per ottenere giustizia per le vittime del massacro del 1988. Il primo luglio di quest'anno ero a Parigi con molti dei relatori presenti e ho potuto vedervi collegato via etere e vedere questo spettacolo oggi dal vivo è una cosa che riempie di grande emozione. Eravamo tantissimi a Parigi, oltre 100.000 persone, rappresentanti e relatori di tutti e cinque i continenti del mondo. È stata una grande vittoria. Nessun altro partito o gruppo politico avrebbe potuto organizzare un evento come questo. Complimenti ai Mojahideen del popolo. Quell'evento, quello straordinario evento, ha dimostrato che la resistenza iraniana con la leadership di Madame Rajavi è un'alternativa credibile, seria, all'attuale regime totalitario e tirannico. Sono certo, siamo certi che il giorno in cui giustizia sarà fatta per il popolo iraniano è vicino. Insieme a voi, membri coraggiosi della resistenza iraniana, noi possiamo e dobbiamo fare sì che quel giorno arrivi presto, presto, now, now.
طاهر بومدرا به کارزار عدالت برای قربانیان قتل عام 1988 در ایران متعهد هستیم. وقتی درباره عدالت صحبت می‌کنیم، می‌خواهیم که عدالت اجرا شود و ببینیم که اجرا شده است.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Sisters, brothers, you remember very well the hard days we spent together in Ashraf. You were persecuted, and I was also at the United Nations persecuted. I lived very, very isolated within the United Nations because I supported you. Now, I must say that I learned a lot from you. Your perseverance, your resistance, your hard work, and above all, your conviction. And I learned from it. This lesson I cherish very much. And I could tell you that the way I was committed to defend you in Ashraf, I am today committed within JVMI, justice for the victims of the massacre of 1988 in Iran. I will not repeat what the previous speakers have said, but I would like you to understand that within JVMI, there are a number of people who are very, very committed. And we are not just committed to try to do things. We are committed to achieve results. So we want, when we speak about justice, we want justice to be done and to be seen to be done. So JVMI was established last year, September 2016 in Geneva. It was launched in the presence of Ms. Betancourt, who her role is absolutely very encouraging and very much supporting. We launched this JVMI in Geneva, and within a short period, we have achieved a lot, including the report that was presented in April 2017. That report had identified the crime. It had identified the laws, applicable laws. It had identified the suspect perpetrators. It had also presented lists of suspected mass graves. This is within 6 months. That was done and was presented and brought to the attention of the United Nations, to the attention of the international community, diplomatic community in Geneva. But that's not it. I'm saying we are deadly, deadly committed to achieve results on the ground. So we will continue identifying the possible jurisdictions that would entertain cases against suspect perpetrators. And the law is on our side. The persecution you suffered from, it has to change camp. They will start from now on negotiating their travel abroad. They cannot just travel without being previously arranging their immunity. Their travel abroad with impunity will come to the end. I will keep a bit of suspense in this for the future coming months. But what I would like to say, I do not want to forget those who were assassinated in Ashraf and in Liberty. Those assassins had to be held accountable as well. So although our focus today is on the crimes of 1988, but we must also focus on the blood that was shed in total impunity in Iraq. So I hope that we will be able to extend, if I could call it, our mandate, JVMI mandate, to cover also those crimes committed in Ashraf and in Liberty. And we also need to work very hard to bring those people, those who committed those crimes, to justice. It is feasible, it's reachable, and we must do it. Thank you very much.